Welcome to the School of Architecture's lecture series held on an atypical Friday night. In order also to welcome our admitted graduate students and their friends and guests. And so welcome to all of those who are here also. Tonight it's a great pleasure to welcome Thomas, aka Tomas, as we used to call him today, Leeser, from Leeser Architecture in New York, UIC. Thomas earned his bachelor's and master's degrees from the Technische Hochschule in Darmstadt, Germany. This is somewhat my invention, frankly. For someone who's so media savvy, it's impossible to find any information about it. You're way under the radar. You have no CVs, nothing. There's no bios out there. Very secret, which I appreciate. So I will invent a story.
You have to be media savvy
to make that away. While he was in Germany, Darmstadt, Thomas did an exchange program at Cooper Union, and I would say, I use the expression, fell in with, is maybe one way to put it. Eisenman Architects, where from 1980 until opening his own office in 1989, he was a partner in charge of design. While at Eisenman Architects, Thomas was responsible for, among other works, the Columbus Convention Center, the Wexner Center, Frankfurt Biocentrum, Checkpoint Charlie Housing Project, and the Eisenman-Derrida relationship / collaboration, which went by the name of Moving Arrows, Arrows, and Other Arrows. It was the 80s. Wordplay and big shoulder pads were big. That was what the 80s was about. Subsequently, Tomas also co-edited a publication on that project with Jeffrey Kipnis. Tomas regularly teaches at Columbia, though if you're thinking about going here at Columbia, don't let that sway you. He's also taught at Pratt, RPI, Parsons, and Princeton. And I will raise one anecdote after the one because it's late. It could be apocryphal because it was told to me by Jeff Kipnis, but it'll be a reason why not to go to Columbia even though Tomas is there, which is that I was told that when a certain dean of that school had just arrived from New Zealand and was staying with a certain Mr. Kipnis, that certain soon-to-be now dean at Columbia would follow Tomas around looking to see where he was shopping for his clothes. Tomas was quite, and still is, the standard of fashion in our field. So it just shows the person who heads up that school needs some help. As a subset to this discussion, we could also talk a little bit about professional practice, which is the issue of how you leave an office and go from working for someone or in an office where you have been an incredibly significant contributor to the discourse and design agenda of that office, and ultimately set up your own office. And I've come to the conclusion that there are three ways to do that, all of which evidenced by a generation that was more or less in the late 80s to early 90s of Eisenman Architects. One way is that you desperately fight for the rights of inheriting a legacy, Ray Lynn. The second way is you do everything you can to slash and burn and reject that legacy, Wes Jones. And the third way is to coolly, and I would say almost indifferently, move on without great fanfare and set off work that's opportunistically connected to that work, but that is also in a completely new genre. And I would say that's the best way to move on, and I would say that's Tomas's way of setting an example for how you operate under the sway and then into your own distinct voice. Soon after starting his own office, Tomas completed the twin house, a house for a pair of brothers, both of whom were surgeons. I always imagined that they would look like Jeremy Irons. I don't know, but I just assumed that that was the case and seeing their winners. So right off the bat, really, Tomas's practice announced its presence on the scene. It was, in fact, early in the collection of the Museum of Modern Art. And although it was never built, although it was incredibly detailed and ready to be built, it really inspired a whole set of other projects that came subsequent to that, such as UN Studios' Mobius House and some of the work by Scott Cohen. I think that Tomas, like other people we invite here who we're friends with, were among the first to see the promised land, although they didn't necessarily get the due credit or get to the promised land first. I think that that's a huge achievement in the discipline of architecture, is actually to make possible work that gets realized later. Most recently, in 2002, Tomas was one of three finalists in the I-Beam competition, along with Dylan Scafidio and MBRDV. 2 years later, Tomas collaborated with MBRDV to produce probably the most interesting of the housing complexes, housing proposals for the New York City's bid for the Olympic Housing Village. And that same year, he also won the competition for the moving image, Museum of Moving Image in Astoria, Queens, which just opened earlier this year, which I'm sure you all have seen. One thing that's of interest for us here, probably, and Thomas's work, such as the museum gives evidence to, is how to integrate and translate, you could say, the graphic protocols of architecture, that is drawing, but not just drawing, but really contemporary image culture at large, into saturated atmospheres that re-script what architecture can do as a cultural practice. And I think Thomas's work is exemplary in that regard. And like an extension himself, is always cool, although incredibly precise and relaxed at the same time. So I'm glad, I didn't know his title was hot cold, but I would say he's between there, he's just cool. And I think that it's the kind of work that, it doesn't make excuses or elaborate claims, it simply takes you somewhere else. And we're very happy that he's here to take us somewhere else with him tonight. Please join me in welcoming Tomas Leeser.
Towards really actually going on there, because There's a museum, and there's also a research lab for DNA research. To make a long story short, it's kind of what the Russians trying to do is, I think they're trying to create a Jurassic Park, they're trying to recreate the mammoth, and they're trying to fuse the DNA of a mammoth with an African elephant, and they're trying to kind of come up. So like, I thought it was really sort of fascinating. So we participated in this competition, which is really in the worst place in the world. It's in the far eastern region of Siberia, on one of the largest rivers in the world. It's the 10th largest river in the world. It's the longest river in the world. It's the largest Russian river, it's kind of the Bering Strait to the right. The next sort of reasonably sized town is Ulaanbaatar. It's 1,500 miles away, and there's nothing in between. So this is what the landscape looks like, which is kind of geomorphology. It's a kind of permafrost surface, which is really, really fascinating when you look at it. These things are actually called pingos. These sort of lakes and hills called pingos, and they are created by freezing and thawing all the time. And it's very difficult to actually build on this ground. The surface is very much like the surface of Mars, actually. It's probably the most inhospitable place on Earth. This is the river, which is in parts like 3 miles wide, and it's of course not regulated. It's, you know, it's floods and it's also, even in summer, if you, I read all these reports of explorers, if you take a boat on this river and you fall into the water, you have about 30 seconds to get out. Summer, it's freezing cold. And this is the town of Yakutsk, about 200,000 people. The whole region is about 400,000 people. Why they need a museum of the size that the competition asked for is beyond me, and I think it's proved to be beyond them eventually as well. What's interesting about this town is, it's on that river, on the Lena River, which is where Lenin actually borrowed his name from, when he was in exile in this region. So it's on the river, and further back at the top of the image is a fairly steep mountain beginning. So like, it's a very interesting landscape. They're completely flat, and then this mountain rises like 45 degrees up higher. This is what the center of town looks like. Everything is basically permanently frozen. And the reports, what I've been reading, I've never made it there. it's not me, but if you take a cup of hot water and throw it up in the air in winter, it instantly freezes into ice crystals. You can see this here, this is sort of, it turns into ice dust, basically. Temperature is about minus 50 degrees. It's the place with the most extreme temperature difference between summer and winter. It is the coldest inhabited place in Earth, this is what can happen if you go away for a weekend, don't keep your house properly heated, and then you have to basically wait until the summer. Transport, the best way to move around is on the river in winter, but it's frozen. If you don't, you may end up like this, and you will not get these levers out until the spring. Problem is, only in spring, this is what the roads look like, because it gets up to 90 degrees hot, and you can see the kind of in extreme climate. They also have rush hour, which sometimes can be quite anyway. So some people get stuck. Some things get stuck, some animals get stuck, and eventually, 50,000 years later, they may be found again, as this mammoth, and they found quite a lot of these fairly intact mammoth, and one of which is actually in an ice cave preserve where it's permanently minus 8 degrees Celsius. So this mammoth is frozen, and they have a whole sort of collection of these. But what's interesting about the landscape is the permafrost creates a kind of pattern, sort of like polygon-like geometries in the ground, which occurs from the constant freezing and thawing. It's kind of the water's being pushed up and freezes and it thaws, and it creates these kind of mounds. I have a series of images of a typical permafrost kind of surface, which you can find in this region. These are kind of lake surfaces. Again, that's from the internet because I didn't go there. If you go to Moscow, it seems to be far. From here to Moscow is about, 11 hour flight. I think from Moscow to Yakutsk is at least the same, if not more. And I asked people in Moscow about Siberia, and they basically have no idea. I mean, for them, it's just as far away as for us, I would say. This is the site, which of course you can see much of the mountain. You can see the mountain left and right, so behind the camera is the sort of steep incline. So what we did, the program is fairly simple, and we wanted to keep this whole thing very simple. So, the program is in the upper, this is how easy it is to design. Okay, this is, I think you need to take some notes, it's very simple. You take the program, you make a box, right? Particularly if you want to build in Siberia in a place where they don't do what is that? What do I call this? Patrick All right, thank you. So you make a box, right? And then you put the program. You figure out how much program you have, and then you look at what's around you. You have a mountain, so you smack the thing into the mountain, and then you figure out how to, so you lift it up, so you can go in below, because particularly if there's a lot of snow, building, you basically produce cover, and then you need to think about how to get the snow off the roof. You can fold a little bit up and down, it's pretty simple, right? So this is what it looks like, right? You take the program, smack it into the hill, you get the snow slide off, and this is where you enter, right? Phil Johnson, I remember Peter Eisman, we did a competition for the Wexner Center, and Johnson came to look at the project, and he said, you guys will lose. So Peter said, why, this is great, it's a great project. Johnson said, I don't know where to enter. So we put a big arrow there, and we have a competition. So that's the most important rule. You have to, when you look at it, you have to know where to enter. So that's the arrow, right? That's where you enter. Anyway, so when you look at the landscape, we work with Balmori landscape architects, Balmori design, to for the landscape, and we came up with this kind of, I guess it's called Voronoi, which is sort of severely overused, but I didn't really care, because it was kind of the geometry that was most appropriate to the sort of landscape pattern we found. At the same time, this is a molecule for an amorphous carbon structure, which is basically what aerogel is made out of. And, aerogel, I mean, maybe we should go back and sort of mention that what was really interesting in the competition brief, it says like it was very important to them that there's very few windows because of this extreme climate. So they said very little glass should be used. And we took a different stance. We decided that the building should be entirely made of glass because aerogel is a material that has the highest insulation value of any material known to man by a factor of 10. It's also super light and it's also translucent. It's a kind of space age material. It does not transfer heat at all because it's primarily gas. So we figured if you would have a building made of glass, two layers of glass and fill it with aerogel, better insulation than anything else. So this is sort of what we did, and we came up with this. This is a kind of aerogel molecular Voronoi permafrost structure, and this is the geometry which I just explained. You know how quickly we easily got to it. So here, the other thing we learned quickly is that when you build in permafrost region, you can't build on the ground. You have to touch the ground as little as possible because any heat transfer into the ground melts your foundation, but the foundation is basically ice. So we put the building on stilts. And then we had the program, sort of this deformed box, deformed by those four steps that I earlier explained. This fractured grid, which is also a geometry not unlike cracked ice, where all the lines are basically optimized kind of geometries in terms of stress on the surface. So the idea is to minimize, because of extreme temperature differences, to minimize stress. So these geometries, at least that's what we claim. This geometry will minimize stress on the building. And then we figured that if we have these legs at the bottom to keep the building up, we also need legs at the top to get lighting. So these are kind of the idea of these columns is to get additional light into them. This is where you have actually controlled very small windows, which can be shut with sort of computer controlled shutters. So they're basically open only when the sun is out, which is not so much in the winter, and therefore the idea of the building being translucent for these aerogel skin. And so it's more or less a little distinct. And I can go a little bit faster through this. But this is what the structure eventually, the structure for the building. The competition, the project never went beyond the competition, so this is the kind of stuff you imagine in the competitions. It's not necessarily that worked out here, let's say. So here's the woolly mammoth, which sits in the cave, underground, permanently frozen, and there's a mountain, and we started with this kind of elevated grid upon which you walk, which is sitting on top of air-conditioned foundations, and these foundations are chilled in order to prevent heat transfer into the ground. The circulation, there's two escalators and two stairs elevators, which also do not touch the ground. They basically end up on that sort of metal grid plaza. The climate enclosure, one of the issues was the temperature difference in summer or winter from outside to inside, because the museum inside is actually also meant to be cool, while it can be very hot outside. So these glass tunnels, we actually have to do quite some temperature differences. And then here there's the structure, and this is sort of the first level. First level above the mechanical lodge. So this is the laboratory. So you have the actual, these are kind of one part of the program, laboratory type things, and then some office type things. And the left and right are gardens, but it's interior gardens because most of the year it's not so pleasant outside, and so we thought it would be nice to have these gardens. So the scientists can wander around the garden and figure out how to recreate the mammoth. And then we have a museum level and some kind of distributive and whatever approach. It's very simple layout, and this is just within this translucent glass box, the light cabinets. This is sort of what it looks like in the section. And this the mechanical room, laboratory, museum level. So it's very simple. We try to keep these plans very straightforward and simple, very diagonal. The gardens, left and right. The section, see the escalator. Now the idea was that since this laboratory program was somewhat hidden within the overall program. This is sort of marketed as a museum. We thought it would be actually really important, here's the laboratory, to make this laboratory visible to every visitor who comes in. It's like the first time you see the escalator penetrating the laboratory level, even though visitors are not allowed to go into this area. You see in the background one of the gardens, which you can then also need to see from the museum. And then there's an escalator, so you go into the museum, and then there's an escalator down that gets into the mammoth cave, which, so the mammoth itself, the main mammoth actually is not going to be in the museum. These are some kind of models we made, some 3D models, and this is what this thing actually looks like. Summer and winter. Summer's not that green, right? Even though it's very hot. I mean, they supposedly have mosquitoes the size of dogs. And if you have to be careful breathing in too heavy in summer because you can choke. It's actually the reason what made me not go there actually, when I was invited to come and I looked a little bit into hotels and so on, and I realized there's only 3 hotels in this town and they all offer bulletproof rooms. And I was like, why do I have a bulletproof room? I've never seen this anywhere else. Then I began to realize the town is actually very wealthy. There's gold mining, diamond mining, nickel, there's gas, oil, and there's a lot of towns there. So in this way, I call it the village because the mafia has a sort of control. And this is also why I think this building will never get built, because they don't want a Bilbao effect. This is the last place that they want. the mafia wants it, really. So. Anyway, so this is the museum level of the garden, and these are the happy scientists. About to get the woolly mammoth and sort of bring it back to life. Let's skip it. This is meant to be done. It's okay, we don't need it. We were invited to, by the Russians to the Biennale, and we built a model. This is like, it's of course not a model you would send to the Biennale, even though it's really tempting to. This is sort of how our interns try to figure out how to do carpet together. But I love this model almost better than this one. This is sort of the model which is a really good model. Not the last one, previous good model. But it gives you a sense of sort of the underneath this building, the size of the building. Okay, while we're in Russia, we also did a project for, which is also very fun, for an oligarch, one of, at the time, before the economic crisis, he was the ninth richest man in the world. I don't quite know exactly what happened to him, but he asked us to design a school for his children. So one of the things that was important, and this is like in the wealthy neighborhood of Moscow where Putin and Medvedev live, and there seems to be not a school for all those rich kids. So the program was to design a school that's like a kindergarten, and then a elementary school, middle school, and a high school. And it was supposed to be built in stages. And I mean, this was never quite literally expressed to us, but I assume the stages were having to do with his kid's age. So the kindergarten would have been the first part, and so on. And then, unfortunately, the economy crashed, and the project sort of stopped. I don't know whether his kids stopped growing as well. This project's a little bit in the but what we were thinking that what we wanted to do is that sort of each school is sort of like its own little entity, that there's no real corridors of the school, that everything is made of glass, everything's completely transparent, and can only be controlled with curtains. And you have like circular rooms where you actually really try to make a building that's only circles, you know, which you almost succeed in as well. But you have like the, you know, the different schools and the different rooms within the schools, the classrooms, everything is sort of like gears working with each other, where you link with the plans. These are the different elements of the school as a kind of, you know, everything is organized around these circular rooms. And it was actually, I was amazed that actually this works quite well. You can actually do something like this. You know, that here you can see how we try to have almost like every school is like a little village. It has its own entity. Once you're outside of this, the classroom, you're in, it's not a corridor, it's an other space, it's more like a public, it's sort of like a street. And if you imagine a city would be built entirely out of circular buildings, what is fantastic about it, that you lose complete orientation, because there's no, there's nothing, you know, straight streets are really important to find your way around. And I was thinking it would be kind of great if school where you get lost all the time. So like you have an excuse when you come late to class and always say like I got lost because there's no straight corridor. So we went through the sort of madness of developing this thing in very detail. And then of course, you know, Bush had to destroy the economy and but this is what I put it sort of look like, I guess. It's sort of in a very sort of rural setting, you know, we wanted it to somewhat blend into the landscape. We had scenarios for summer gardens and winter gardens. You know, this is Moscow, it's also fairly cold, but it's nothing compared to Siberia. Then it's sort of from cold Moscow to rainy London. We were asked by the mayor of London to come up with a proposal for something completely useless, which would be sitting in the middle of the Olympic Park, so here you see the stadium. I guess he would call it a folly or something. It wasn't clear to the city, and it wasn't clear to us what it would be. But it was something that we were supposed to, it was supposed to be somewhat iconic in the kind of center of this Olympic Park that would be able to survive the Olympics. And it's a little bit outside of London. So what we thought would be actually nice, since there's nothing nearby to see that was interesting, it would be nice to see the skyline. So what we came up with this, and it's sort of like in this little river, but we came up with this idea of a floating lake. Which you could go up to, and you know, in the summer it would be fantastic to be in this sort of you know, like 6-inch deep lake, and it kind of flows over on the edge. You know, you could hang out there underneath. There's a kind of covered sort of space for performances and so on. Now, since you know, the thing London is most famous for is its rain. We thought we would make rain sort of an iconic element of this project. So you can see the edge there. That's where it's raining. This is sort of what it would look like above. You know, that would be a fantastic place, you know, to overlook the city and not see the Olympic buildings because they're below you. So you have this fantastic horizon. At the same time, you know, underneath the street performance and this, the edge, that it appears as if the lake is overflowing all the time. But the rain is a kind of digitally controlled water curtain that you can send messages. You know, of course, you can imagine if Brits would lose one of the games, you kind of messages would be sent. It's also the way what happens if you approach this performance space underneath this floating lake, the water wall would stop. It would sense that you're approaching, it would stop and let you go in, and it starts again. So, you know, it becomes kind of playful, iconic London rain symbol. And this is supposedly the mayor loved it, but then they didn't quite know what it was for. And so it's this is a very funny project. I mean, it's called Y2Z because this is a house of state in New York, which also never will happen because the client couldn't keep his fingers of the bulldozer. It's a side of the Hudson, overlooking the Hudson. So you see in the back of the Hudson, you see this big hole in the front. This hole comes from this bulldozer that this client loves to have, you know, sort of drive around the side and cut holes. And, you know, there's another hole. And the problem is that we started designing this house, and he wanted like every room, you know, I mean, he wanted to look at the river, of course, right? It's like at night, it's, you know, this town, it's late, and then it's this and that. So every room, we designed the house where every room was oriented towards the view that he imagined would be best. And this is what it was called, the Y house, because it was kind of like, we made a lot of versions because he could never quite decide which way he wanted to look. And every time he came back to the site, he had cut another hole to the site. So everything, you know, he had to change everything again. And so we have like, you know, hundreds of these models with very subtle changes because we had to, you know, reconfigure the view a little bit here, out there, and sat there, and looked. No, no, it's not the right angle. So I guess, you know, we spent a lot of time on this thing. And this is sort of one version of what it looked like until then. Again, the economy crashed, and he sort of said that it has to become very simple and cheap. So what we came up with, which is then called the Z house, therefore the Y2Z, which is basically a very straightforward box. It's a slightly leaning, on the, you know, it's like has a sloping, the whole floor is basically, the whole house is kind of sloping. So you see this. It was actually funny, we first wanted it to be all glass, and we discovered there's such thing as an energy code. And we're not allowed to build a house all out of glass, even with aerogel. So we had to come up with this half glass, half, you know, this black wall there. So we made it 50-50, which is the, according to the energy code, is acceptable, 50% glass, 50% solid, so half of it. And this is sort of more or less what this thing looks like. It's a little bit hard to see how it's leaning, but it's leaning here. You can see it's sort of tilting because one side of the side is he cut more away than the other side. That's why the, you know, we tilted the house. And we eventually, you know, we got the building permit, we got everything going, and then he went in there with the bulldozer again. And at that point, he has to pay us more money for making these changes, and then we never heard from him again. I mean, you know, if you guys want to be architects someday, you mentioned professional practice. You know, this is a lecture on professional practice, as you have noticed. Yeah, since it's not a lecture on architectural theory, this is where Bob is having a lot of fun. All right, so Museum of the Moving Image. It's another very funny project. This is the first building I actually ever really built in my office, which is funny, which is, you know, I'm actually sort of, I have to admit, I'm proud of it, because usually architects build some shitty house. And this is a little bit bigger than that. So like, I waited longer, you know, lots of, I think it was worth the wait. This is a rendering, because you can't photograph this building. This view, it's the sad side, you know, it's basically in the backyard. The front of the building is an existing warehouse building, not particularly attractive, which we couldn't tear down because it's the National Register of Historic Places, which means it's not necessarily an important building, but it's an important place. And we doubled the size of the actually, what's funny, that there was a competition, and the original budget was $2.7 million to repaint the lobby. we first thought, like, you know, is this going to be serious? Is it worth doing this? And, I had this feeling it was. We ended up with a budget of $65 million, which is a pretty good factor. But I think it made it worthwhile spending 6 years reprogramming until we were at this level where it was actually worth the museum to just do anything. So this is what it looks like from the back. There's a courtyard in the back, and this is, you know, the view from the back. This is a section of the building. You can kind of see the different, you know, the new theater. This is the lobby with the cafe. This is a student entrance. One of the reasons why we won the competition, and I'm not going to mention names who we competed against, but I'm sure you know what was all of them, was that the client said, like, we were the only ones who understood their problem. We were not pushing a certain kind of design idea or some kind of noodle we understood the problem that they had, why they needed an addition or an expansion more beyond painting the lobby. And this is why we won the competition. One of the things we proposed immediately is to have the students enter from create a separate entrance for the students, because the museum's typical problem is students come in, school classes make a lot of noise and interfere with kind of regular visitors. And this was for that museum particularly problematic because it's out in Queens, it's not the center of New York, there's lots of tourists, it's a kind of strange place. This is what we call a video screening amphitheater, which I'll talk a little bit about later. Changing exhibition gallery, straightforward collection storage. So then it's a fairly simple program. It's an extremely tight site, and this is the existing building. We had very little room to alter the facade, basically no room to alter the facade, because it is on the list of historic important places. So, you know, we could only do three window bays or something. So that was one limitation. The other limitation was budget, of course, to sort of do this entrance. So what we did, we made a gigantic sign that is the name of the museum itself, which is basically it's a translucent mirror. In some early iterations, we had ideas of like using like hundreds of small video screens, you know, to make a kind of large image, and it's all pretty, pretty expensive. But what I wanted to do is I wanted this feeling that you actually break through the screen to the museum. So you break not only through this kind of mirror and screen, but you also break through the main facade itself. So when you open the door, you know, you sort of like an act of aggression in a certain way. The idea is that you, as a visitor to the museum, you are not just kind of passive, meant to passively viewing art, but you're supposed to in some way become or participate in the museum experience as a media museum. So this idea of interacting with work is particularly important. So you know, it's a kind of act of pulling the idea of a museum off its pedestal. This is the joint between the old and the new building. The new building, I don't have to say it too quite obviously. The facade, you know, it's very hard to design buildings that have no windows or no, you know, have really nothing much going on, like kind of a flat surface. So we emphasize the idea of flatness. We actually developed this skin, folds and bends, not unlike what you find on the back of a Kellogg's box, where you cut out like, you know, Schwanstein or something and fold it and, you know, make a little paper building. This, you know, idea of scoring and folding and cutting And so you see here, for example, this sort of bottom, there's a few panels still missing. There's a kind of a fold, and there's a cut, and there's four. There's these kind of subtle differences between operations, spatial operations. This is a rendering, which is really amazing. The building actually looks, I mean, we tried very hard to make the building look like a rendering. This is like a little bit side thing. The structure, what's sort of interesting about the structure, it's extreme. The center of the building is basically built like a bridge, because the projection booth, because of the tightness of the site, the projection booth had to be up there, and at the same time the lobby underneath it didn't have any columns. So you have this incredible bridge in order to prevent the projector from vibrating from, external interference. So there's a lot of steel in this building. And there's, sort of the scheme of sort of the way we developed the scheme, we did not use any kind of caulking. It's an open joint system. We wanted these panels to be paper thin, or feel like really super thin, and the joints all to be open. And the effect of it is actually, when you see this building, in reality, the skin looks like, it looks a little bit like a spaceship because the edges are all extremely sharp. As a consequence of this idea, what's underneath the skin is a complex system of rain gutters. So these are all, gutters basically. Water is allowed to go behind the metal panels and run down this diagonal grid, which is also meant to prevent or minimize streaking from the, because if you caulk joints, you typically get sort of streaking. So this is what the building looked like before we put the panels on. There was a moment that we should stop now. This is a great. We don't really have, of course, bought those panels. So here, this is sort of how this system looks like, and this is what this sort of flattened surface of the unit is. Really, literally, you can cut this thing out and build. And this is what this puzzle of these panels. They're about 1,100 panels, and the. What I learned while we're doing this is that actually we do triangular panels as opposed to square. It becomes infinitely more complex. Because a triangle is very hard to kind of adjust if you're not accurate in your measurement. You immediately see we have a tolerance, although this building is 200 feet long, we have a tolerance of a 16th of an inch, which is sort of totally unheard of. You can build a Swiss watch with this kind of tolerance. For building, this is what I've heard of, and they, of course, it's very funny, at some point they had delivery of panels that had the wrong numbers on them, and they completely puzzled it. It was sort of continuing, it started to look like a gigantic jigsaw puzzle. Anyway, so it was a lot of fun, and here you can see those open joints and the kind of crispness. This is with eventually the glass facade finished. We tilted this facade out forward because the garden, which is not finished yet, and it's literally not finished yet. It's going to be done hopefully sometime soon. The garden will be powder blue astroturf, and the glass is tilted. Because across the garden is a really ugly building, a new building that we didn't want to reflect in the window. Meanwhile, I wanted this little astroturf to be. So when you stand in the garden, you see yourself it has a kind of a 30% mirroring, which is a very light mirror. So you see yourself in the mirror, sort of leaning, and you see behind the glass of somebody standing there. People sort of see it. So you get this sort of collapse of images where you see yourself as you see somebody behind the glass in this kind of folded space. And the same effect is happening from the inside. Actually, the floor runs towards the glass, and at night when the light gets at the floor, it seems to kind of disappear down into the sort of angle of the fold. So the folding here, the folding of the glass is deliberate on the idea that the glass reflects light into this behind. Yeah, you see, of course, right now it reflects dirt because that's what it's good. This is the sort of semi-transparent mirror that had to be brought in from Germany because nobody else seems to make it. Not sure why only the Germans make transparent mirror, but there must be some story about this, I don't know. So this one looks like from the inside, the lobby. You can sort of see the main rooms inverted. The front desk. Now the floor, I should point out, the floor is not white. It doesn't not only look like this in the photographs, it also looks like this in the actual space at this moment. Everybody thinks the floor is white until you come to certain areas where you suddenly realize it's actually very light blue. This is the shop, the film shop. I don't have some images. This blue wedge is the entrance into the theater itself, which is a little bit like this entrance into a spaceship. This is a rendering. I mean, I think we got, this is also a rendering, I think we got pretty close with the space looking exactly like a rendering. This cafe to the right, and we are now underneath the theater. They see a edge blend 5 projector video wall, and it's technically quite complicated. Sure, images consist across 5 projectors. The stair to the upper galleries and this pink entrance is a smaller screening room. It's a seamless floor, which is cast throughout. It's matte and it has a very light blue color. There's moments where the blue, it produces a kind of almost a digital electric effect. It's very subtle. As I said, sometimes it looks white. When it's everything around is white, it looks white. When it's not so bright, it sort of comes through. And we were very interested in this idea of what colored light can do, what color can do. So we have the theater is all covered in Yves-Klein blue. The Yves-Klein blue is an extremely intense color that produces a kind of disorienting effect in this Yves-Klein blue light. It's sometimes hard to understand how far away you are from that. And we wanted this effect in the theater. You contrast it with this image is a little bit of color, it's a little funny. You contrast it with this kind of aqua blue, teal color to push the light a little bit. And the theater seating itself is actually suspended above this sort of light cope. So these blue felt panels, these acoustic panels, they wrap underneath the seats to give you the sensation of floating. And this is the screen. This is actually a curtain. This image is a curtain for the screen, which is an image of an anechoic chamber, which is basically a sound dead space. The idea here is that you have this intense blue light, which disorients your vision, with this sort of association to the sound dead environment of acoustic spaces. And of course, the first film that we screened is Stanley Kubrick's 2001, which is kind of like the theater is like the spaceship of Kubrick's film. I don't know whether you have seen it nowadays, but people seem to be too slow for. If you're younger than 40, it's too slow for you. So this is more or less what this theater looks like. This curtain is pretty wild, I have to say. It's sort of. I do wish you had a curtain like this. And once you leave the theater, you're sort of leaving, it's like leaving a spaceship. Theater is similar, except now it's like hot pink, so it's intense hot pink to enter into the theatre itself, which this theatre is more technical, it's more minimal. It's sort of like a space for cineasts. It's like, this is sort of where you see movies that nobody wants to see. It's, we wanted to make this a little more, somewhat more technical, but at the same time, the red, this hot pink, has a similar effect as the blue. It's very disorienting color, particularly when it's light. And this is the video screening amphitheater. This is sort of our version of what the MoMA has, when they show video art. They typically have blue and black curtains, and it's completely pitch black, and you have to go in there, and you sit down, and you always feel a little strange. And nobody ever stays there for more than 10 seconds. And, so we wanted to avoid this sort of problem, and we wanted to put this kind of space right in the middle of basically your circulation. So in the back you see the stair coming out. And this image right now is smaller than the screen. The video screen actually reaches across all the way to the right. And also it wraps down into the stair, to the ceiling of the stair, and it turns into the ceiling of the mounting below. So this idea is that the projected image is a surface that can actually span across the time zone. So more or less every surface is projected on. At the same time, when you come up from the lobby through this stair, it is like you're emerging from below the projected video. It's like you are as if you're stepping out of the image into the space. And then the stair on the right goes further up to changing exhibition space. This door to the right is the existing galleries. So this is looking the other way. We come up the main stair and there's some seating. Carefully is the connection to the existing galleries and the stair up to the peripheral galleries. This is the upper part of the stair. There's the student orientation space, the classrooms are made with curtains because not only did we save money, but we also made the space flexible for special events, as well as classroom. All right, I have a small section of stuff that I'm just going to go through quickly. I was saying in the beginning, this is sort of like a cross section of work we've been doing, and these are some projects we attempted to get in the Emirates. We were asked by developers to make proposals and it's a series of sort of residential projects. And they're very often interested in sort of Islamic patterns. And so we did a couple of studies of things, some gardens, how you can deal with water and patterns and green and these red things on buildings. And we developed sort of towers. Sort of a diagram of how the plants stack up in space and how you can have high buildings across each other. This is like we designed basically 30 towers where apartments never quite look into each other's windows, where you have sort of exterior gardens that can be made into interior spaces. So, so these are kind of sort of conceptual diagrammatic projects. A spiral stair that's a double helix, it's a fire stair that runs through individual apartments as you have. You can see the stair sort of like a sculpture rather than being sort of solid stair. And there were some other projects that were kind of spun from this that were asked by developers to come up with ideas for projects that they didn't even know exactly what it would be themselves, whether it would be condominiums or hotels. So we came up with this kind of idea of a zipper where you can have different size units on this line, and then you fold it around to kind of zoning, within the zoning envelope, and you may end up with something sort of like this. These are kind of study projects of what we could potentially do. There's a series of ideas of sort of garden towers that, basically villas that are stacked up on top of each other. And then we were asked to do a competition for for a hotel in Abu Dhabi, where the circle is, where the site is, which is also where Zahar Hadid built a gigantic bridge, which I think used up all the concrete of the Emirates at the time. We had a fairly small site, and it's actually not a particularly big building, where we saw this hotel, as a kind of the idea was, like where each room is like a house. It's along the street, so that instead of having a hotel corridor, you have really a hotel street. And in order to execute this idea, we were thinking it would be like the Guggenheim. You wrap it up, and you can do, you can go up, and from your room you can keep walking down, and you get to all the kind of hotel amenities that are being sort of offered. So it's sort of like a ramp that continues with the rooms, and then every once in a while, as an extension, it's either the business suites, offices, or it's the spa, the gym, or it's the restaurant, or the disco, whatever it is. So we have like three of those, the business, the spa, and the lab pool, the dining pool, and the top. So we have these three zones that are kind of special zones, and then the rest is more or less this kind of spiraling hotel. We cut away half the site. The building was meant to, the project was actually meant to be sitting on land, but we took half the site to cut it away and made water and put the building on the edge of the water. For two reasons. One reason, of course, nice to see on the water, but the other reason was like everybody in Dubai and in Abu Dhabi has like a Ferrari or Porsche or something like this. And we thought it would be a lot of fun to have a drop-off. You go to the hotel, you give the key to the concierge, to the valet guy, and he takes your car and drives it into the garage. It happens only to the fact you can't see the entrance to the garage, and it looks like it's driving to the ocean. You have this sort of overall brand, and so you find a kind of a nice intro to this hotel. And there's like a series of plans that what this looks like is a running track, a gym, the lab pool, hotel rooms, upper restaurant with a swimming pool that I think it would be nice to have a glass at the bottom on the 10th floor. There's sort of a section that looks like. And I think the reason why we won the competition, I mean, I don't know what the other projects look like, but when I presented this to the sheikh who was in charge of this thing, I told him this is the only place in the entire Middle East where you can push a button and you can make it money in the lobby. He was like, wow, this is really cool. So, I think that's what won us the competition. He felt that so. Because water is really, it's a very tricky thing in this area. So this is what this thing looks like, an animation. Inside the lobby, you come up. So basically, first you come up with this business suite, and then you keep walking up, ramping around. But sitting on the water is really important. The problem only is that it's so goddamn hot that it's sometimes not so nice to sit in the water. So we developed this glass curtain that can be opened and closed, and so it's open and allows air to circulate through, but it can also be closed. So you can basically sit on an air-conditioned exterior space, which is, of course, completely privileged, because to air-condition this. But this is the Emirates. They still have oil, and the air is burning while they have it. And this is what the lobby looks like from above. So this is the scale of the street. As you walking down, walk by cafes and stores and so on. That's a community. It's not the Guggenheim street. But it's a lovely way, but here's the waterfall, the kind of main. This is the running track. The tricky thing about the running track is if you have a spiral, you either go up or you go down, but when you run, you don't want to have to down on top or bottom, and you want to keep running in circles. So we had to we have a cheat in this building, which I've never told anybody. There's a moment where it's actually not a spiral, because you've been round and round and it's one in the same place, even though everything else is a spiral. I don't quite know why, I don't remember how we did it, but it works. And to the right there, they say, where these people are sitting is the lab pool. Underneath this extension are the kind of VIP suites, and there's a lounge where you can sit around, and typically you sit around, you know, like some kind of, you know, aquarium with sharks. But we used the lab pool for the place, you would sit around, so underneath this spot. So if you see your fellow hotel guests instead of sharks in the air, which is, can be good for the concept. And this is the rooftop, this is the little pool. There's too many palm trees here, but then you have a glass bar pool and a bar and so on. We had to stop ourselves from not putting a helipad on there. You know, the rooms, whatever. Anyway, so this, yes, all right, so now, where we were, we still, yeah, now this is a project where I'm not supposed to say where it is. And I'm not supposed to say that it's for the royal family either. We didn't know this initially, but there was a competition as well. It's a brief. The brief was sort of like, imagine a greenhouse in an iconic greenhouse in an unknown site. So we thought that it's at some kind of highway intersection. And we, you know, designed this thing, and we won a competition, only to be told that it's actually highly confidential, and you know, we're not supposed to say, you know, they didn't even tell us, for the second stage of the competition, they still didn't tell us exactly where it was. Even though you can find it on Google Maps really easily. So this was the first, so the idea was that, you know, they wanted a greenhouse in the desert of Abu Dhabi. I mean, this is really crazy, right? They wanted a greenhouse with Mediterranean climate for three climate zones. There's a kind of moderate, there's Mediterranean, and there's tropical, which should have year-round some fruits you could pick. And first I wanted to propose actually build a supermarket, because it would be much easier. So I think that wasn't sort of, I guess, sort of stylish enough. So this has kind of three climate zones, and it's basically meant for state visitors to come and, you know, she is going to receive people and, you know, they pick some apples. The funny thing is, you know, which is something I guess I didn't really ever think about it, but any fruit-bearing tree, particularly ones that grow in the Mediterranean, they need a winter season. So you actually have to cool this thing down in the winter to fairly low temperature in order for those trees to bear fruit. Which creates a very interesting dilemma right now that we're sort of dealing with. This is sort of, actually before we start construction, we still haven't solved all those problems. These are like, you know, several stages of this development of this project. This is sort of the underside. We had to get rid of these kind of floating parts with water ponds below that we really wanted to, because but we wanted this sort of undulating Mediterranean type landscape. Rather than a completely flat greenhouse. I mean, it's really not so much a greenhouse, it's really more a biosphere, and which has kind of meeting rooms. These blue bubbles, they are what's called modules, which are basically meeting rooms, and they're gender separated. So there's one for women, there's one for men. And the one for women has to look like it's higher than the one for men, but the men has to be higher than the one for men, because it's the So it's a kind of a very, very tricky arrangement and a very complex sort of organization system because for who the client is. And, you know, and it's very hard to get straight answers from them. It's a very sort of interesting thing. But the funny thing right now we're dealing with is that we have, in order to not burn all the oil that they have in a few years, we do have to prepare our thorough environmental conscious and make sure that this is not, not too hot without an air conditioning system that's twice the size of the building itself. So we're having this very funny problem that either it gets too hot or it's too dark, which is very hard to believe in so much sun, so much heat. So it's really a very strange project to build in the desert. But anyway, so I don't know. I could stop now, or I could show you what we're working on currently, which is another crazy project. It's a mall in Thailand, in Bangkok. From a client who had seen our Helix Hotel, and she called us and said, I need you to come, by the way. We started construction. I want to design my 300,000 square foot shopping mall, 11 story shopping mall with a IMAX theater and six or eight other theaters and 30 meter, 100 foot tall waterfall, or whatever. We thought it was something crazy because in Iceland we had people calling up, and it turned out they called the nurse next to them from some insane asylum. But we said, oh, send us business class tickets, so we're coming. We actually, the money came, we went, and we said, okay, we can do this thing, but if you want to do something like the Helix, the thing has to be like a Helix. It's like, okay, we'll do it. What does that mean? So she built in front of her house the next morning. Her entourage built this ramp. It's actually very funny. It's a very funny movie called The Ramp. I don't know if you guys know. It's a good one. But anyway, so she built this ramp overnight. She had this ramp built to see how steep the ramp would be to build this thing, Because we had a child in a wheelchair, there she's in the yellow, in this yellow shirt. And so it passed, passed all the kind of, passed her financial advisor. Everybody thought it was worth it, it's 120. And then we sort of, basically what we're doing is we just designed something that's no more than 50 centimeters thick. We basically just designing the surface of this. Everything else was already, they built it already, so the structures are coming out of the ground, and we're kind of frantically trying to catch up with them and design the skin, and every time, it's very funny, because every time you move this thing over a little bit, it's like an argument whether it's a stool or not, and she has these people sitting in her living room, like 10 engineers sitting in these, 10 mechanic engineers, 5 structural engineers, and they're sitting in her house, and she calls them over and says, can you figure this out? The architects don't do this. And they sit there. 2 hours later, they say, okay, it's cool. All right, okay, you can have it. This is how we sort of currently work. It's very funny. Anyway, maybe I think now is the time for a barbecue. Or maybe if you have any questions. It looks like a piece of potato, right? Thank you.
This is a sloppy personal question.
manifesting itself with an overcomplicated geometric expressionism, to use Patrick. Did you see, was it a sort of conscious decision, or did you sort of move into this slack or?
No, it's very conscious. The thing is, I think that, for me, the difficulty is to find the space between. It's easy to go to it's Patrick Schumann, but this is, I think the more difficult thing is it's in the subtleties, it's sort of like in between. It's actually very funny, this building, if you look at Bangkok, a lot of buildings in Bangkok have white horizontal stripes. Now, to do a building that's white horizontal stripes is actually quite challenging in Bangkok, to not make it look like those regular condominium buildings. At the same time, there's future systems of building another mall in Bangkok right now that's like, it's very much like this AHA building. To find the space in between the kind of ordinary everyday and kind of extreme and AHA, which the thing that still allows you to discover or see something that really surprised in a way. And the thing, same with the museum. To build a museum, Bilbao has set a certain kind of expectation. So museums can look like objects. To build a museum that is actually not following the same expressiveness and business, I find much harder. So at the museum, we stayed away from curves, we stayed away from all this idiom language. Liberally sharp edges and thin, very sort of hard and and then there's which was sort of like the challenge. So it's definitely a conscious decision to find a space that's sort of between these six rooms.
Why is part white, and then like when it's not white? Why was it not
white? White is just white, right? It's sort of like it's a good sort of it's a good starting point. When it's not white, it's color. In theater, color is really intense. Because it's sort of disorienting. White is also disorienting. In the museum, which is hard to see in the photographs, the floor is not white, but it appears, there's time to appear white, and then suddenly red and so on. And so that kind of moment of surprise, I think, allows you with either very subtle colors, or the color is so intense that it's clearly, it's almost disturbing. You can't even, and I think in the movie theaters where you go, today, today movies are so gaudy and violent or kind of special effects. They're so overwhelming that you need to do something that changes your sense when you're in the theater before you even start. And there's sort of, you see, blind rule, it depends on how pain it does that. As you go in there, it's, then you can see anything. It's either the subtle world, or you have to kind of work against the power of movies with it. You have to kind of do something with it. And the rest is white. White is just white. Why the white gallery? It's like, why not? It's like, for me, it's an interesting question, right?
Yeah, I think it's a bad choice, and I'm wondering why. It's so relentlessly light in presentation and execution, and a few times it's not, and it's clear there's a reason why not. Just not white is probably the most interesting non-white color choice.
We have you can see in some of the images, you can see this it's very light. Rouge below, which is sort of like, it's like ice. Actually, we model the color of the floor to of the icebergs. We looked at a lot of icebergs, which is very, very hard actually to make this color. When you look at some of these images where the boundary point has this kind of exactly this much of the world, which is very, it's like aerogel. I don't even know what aerogel looks like. It's an incredible otherness to it.
In the back, I want to understand this to. Yeah, no.
Your addition to the Museum of Moving Image kind of remind me of like James Joel kind of pieces. I was wondering if you often sort of look, or if you had his work in mind or other artists in mind for any of them.
Do I have artists in mind? Yeah, sometimes I do. It's not. James Joel is sort of interesting in many ways. It's not so much that we were trying to come close to James Joel or any other artists, but I think the art world is sort of very important. It provides a kind of escape from the world of architecture sometimes. But you can take it to the room. But what's interesting about James Joel, this working with light is like a scaleless, and it works in many different levels. That's why I think it's interesting. What's interesting about James Joel's work is this kind of loss of distance and space. That's sort of what we were trying to achieve in these theaters, but in a theater. Lose a moment of reality with those intense color. Yeah.
It's going to be that you spent the first 10, 15 minutes of the presentation talking about the site, and then I don't remember seeing a site plan and any of the other projects.
Yes. I true. I never thought of site plans. I think the site is interesting for what it holds, not so much how you draw it. You're right. Site, but I was actually, you're right, when I was looking at the lecture, I was like, I have very few real drawings in here. I don't know about site plans. No, but the site is important. I mean, that for me, the site in Siberia is amazing, the site is incredible. This flatness, the mountain, this kind of strange texture, the fact that there's dead animals stuck in the mountain. That's the site. And this whole idea of the history, the whole thing with this permafrost and the woolly mammoth, this scientists don't understand why, let's put it this way, scientists are beginning to understand that. How the climate has changed because the woolly mammoths could not survive today in Siberia. They're finding them now, so the climate must have been different. This whole context. It's actually, the Siberian project is doing really more about global warming than the world itself. It's actually extremely
environment. Was it changing the whole way that you practice? Because that project, even the shape of it, is quite site-related. Mm-hmm. Whereas this thing, you came in after the fact anyways, but it looks exactly like the one in Abu Dhabi.
Yeah.
That's what I mean, is it wasn't a total shift. The thing is, you go back to
this is also a site, like Abu Dhabi here, the same problem is you have, you have to go out somewhere, right? And it's a hotel, it's a mall. They're not so different. All these hotels and all the malls in Abu Dhabi and the Emirates don't say everything actually happens in hotels, which are malls and all this. And this is not unlike that thing. So it's all about the vastness of space, the continuation of space. Space, which is sort of made possible through air conditioning. this kind of endless space, and you know, by wrapping it, you make this thematic, and you make it legible. It's not just a stack of boxes. It's really, really beautiful. And so the hotel and the mall, in that sense, are very similar. The project in Siberia is completely different. It's why it looks different, almost differently. It operates differently because the program at the site such conditions. But it doesn't mean that the Bangkok project and the hotel are not also in some way site specific, because you have to go up. This is only this is only a small part of this project. So it's fairly, it takes a lot of ground, but it's nonetheless this idea that this sort of endless shop is also it's in a way. I mean, the thing is, I think most of my projects, always they relate to the site, but not in the kind of traditional sense. There's some sort of information that has to do with its specific location and program that somewhat fills into the design. It's like this woman that's pointed, yeah, I've been to architecture school, it's this way. It's actually that one. I don't know why she knows that's not interesting. Maybe it's a Chicago one. Anyway, sorry.
I'm curious about if you feel like the twin house and the later on,
of the museum, it sort of evolved having to do with, we didn't want to have the curves for the sake of time, of course, so it had to become a bit of a fashion style. It also then kind of, I don't quite know exactly how it also happened, and every project is sort of like this, I think, even though the Bangkok Mall, the hotel, kind of similar in a way, but most of our projects are very different. It's something that maybe they haven't done before. And I don't know, we may never do try it again, I don't know. Building something, of course, also changes the way you can come up with things, particularly in the museums. So mine is very tight. It's not a revolve. It's a public room. It's a page of the city as well. So that adds significantly to it. But most construct things are different. It's not quite the same as if you look at Zaha's building, which you might now have in Japan, they have construction budgets. And this is like building things is really different. Just I'm not only able to do this. The job is to keep things sort of in focus when you start to look. nothing for us to do for people business there, because this is Thailand, to keep control. It's going to be hard. The difficult part for us is going to keep control. It's all in Thai, it's in Thai. There's a nice local architect involved. We'll see. And this the client here with the entourage for me in my office, and she's waiting for me to come back. He said, well, something that Thomas Thomas back. Does he have to be there? Yeah, she wanted me to cancel the flight.
Is she already had it?
No, but she usually gets what she wants anyway, so.